Hi, welcome to this week's episode of The Shtick. It's just the end of season 48 and the first segment of season 49 for The Shtick. And we have in the studio a guest by the name of Catherine Cashmore.
Yeah, hello.
Hi, welcome to The Shtick. Tell us, what's your shtick?
Well, I'm president of an organisation called Prosper Australia, which is interested in economic reform, particularly taxation reform, to assist housing affordability.
Last week we had a chap on called Philip Kingston, who spoke about real estate in general. Mm. And you're more into the research side of it.
That's right. Well, I do two roles. So first of all, I'm president of Prosper Australia, which is concerned with the research side of it. We do an enormous amount of research on the housing market. And the other role that I take is I'm a buyer advocate. So I do also work in the real estate industry, assisting buyers to purchase homes.
And what are the issues that you find are most pressing for our economy and also for the people who are struggling to buy into the housing market?
Well, our economy promotes the speculation of land. Obviously, housing sits on land, but our economy promotes speculation in housing, which makes housing unaffordable, and it discourages productivity and labour with the taxation policies that we have at the moment. So that is why the housing market is as expensive as it is, and that can be reformed very simply.
Mm. And other things that you actually look at are very important for people who want to know a bit more about what's going on. And you've been on a lot of shows. I know that I've seen you on The Circle and on the 7:30 Report and on The Project recently. And also you were on radio recently as well, on national radio. What do you mainly talk about there?
Well, there's a lot of concentration in government at the moment about how to make housing more affordable. It is the most pressing concern that we have in our economy at the moment, because as soon as you make land unaffordable, you really sow the seeds of destruction for the economy, because we all need land. Land is important to us. We eat on it, sleep on it, work on it. Everything that we do involves land. So when we make land unaffordable, it affects every other area of the economy. So a lot of the commentary that I do in the media and a lot of the work that I do is talking to government and talking to policymakers about how they can implement reform to assist housing to become more affordable. And as I said, that is it's the reforms that we need are simple, but they're politically challenging, particularly when we have a nation that has been effectively breastfed on the notion that your house price is going to fund your retirement, and the way to get rich is to speculate on housing and allow the price to go up and then of course sell it to the next buyer who's got to come along and pay a higher price for the property. So there's a lot of political difficulties as to changing policy when we've gone this far down the line, but it is absolutely necessary that we do to avoid economic destruction.
It's very difficult for anyone at the bottom of the housing structure to buy in. I think that's one of the real issues. And how do you think people can do that? Because the issue that I'm talking about now is decentralisation, in a sense, where people have to start looking either in the country or in the very outer suburbs.
Which often isn't practical for people because we haven't provided or we haven't funded the infrastructure for those suburbs, which again comes down to a lot of what we do at Prosper Australia is learning how to fund those things effectively. But how people get into the housing market at the moment is through a number of different means. Usually they inherit money or they borrow money from their parents. There's all sorts of government implementations that they put forward which really only make housing more unaffordable, such as removing stamp duty for first home buyers or allowing first home buyers to use their super funds to purchase real estate. Those types of reforms don't assist housing to become more affordable, but they are effectively putting money into first home buyers' pockets. So in some sense, they feel like, you know, that's a leg up for them. It's not really.
Mm. I really laughed when Malcolm Turnbull was on John Fain's show and he said, oh, just buy your kid a house.
That's right.
It's that simple.
Get a good job. That's all you need to do.
Yeah,
that's
well, that was Joe Hockey.
Yeah, well, a few have said that.
Get a good job and you're in.
Because it's easier to concentrate on things like that or to say that we just have a supply problem than it is to really get down to the nub of the matter, which is taxation reform. We have to remove speculation from the housing market, and you can only do that through taxation reform. So what we talk about at Prosper is removing taxes of labour and productivity, allowing people to keep their earned income and encouraging them to earn, and yet putting taxes on land and discouraging, taking away the unearned income. The land price when it goes up is an earned income. if we do that, then you effectively do take speculation out of the house.
Yeah, I think one of the issues you cover quite a lot is vacancy.
That's
I think
right.
That was something that Philip Kingston and I discussed last week, and he said, "Oh no, there's no vacancy problem."
Yeah, that's right. Of course, whereas, he hasn't done a study into it.
Well, yeah. It's in his interest. It's in his interest to see that the prices are going up because he makes more money. But for people who are struggling, it's really difficult.
Yeah. Well, I mean, as I said, one of the problems that we've got with government is that they're always saying we don't have enough supply. So the study that we do at Prosper Australia is to look at water usage data to assess how many homes are sitting vacant over a 12-month period or more, not using any water over that 12-month period, so you can tell that there's nobody living at home. Yet those properties aren't advertised for rent and they're not advertised for sale. And I can tell you in the last study that we did, we found around 80,000 properties across the greater metropolitan area of Melbourne that were potentially sitting vacant for a 12-month period or more. Now, Treasury and a lot of policymakers have taken very serious note of that study, which is why they're talking about implementing a vacancy tax now. But it's vital we look at those components to take away the idea that this is a supply problem. We have enough supply, it's just being hoarded.
And the other thing that Philip and I discussed was overseas buyers. And he said, oh, bring it on, you know. And of course, it's again in the interest of real estate agents and speculators to bring that on. And their properties just keep going up and up in value.
Of course. Well, if you work in the real estate industry, and as you know, I work in the real estate industry as well. Yeah. I mean, your funding is really mostly from people that are investing and speculating on housing. And even home buyers do this when they buy a house. They are very concerned with how high the price is going to go over that period of time that
especially
they own the property.
Especially in terms of negative gearing.
Well, negative gearing is one component. The halving of the capital gains tax for investors is a much bigger component that we need to do. So there's all sorts of reforms that we need to do in the housing market. One is we need land taxation. We need to remove stamp duty, replace it with a broad-based land tax. But these things should be done as a change to the taxation system. Taxes should come off productivity and income, and they should be put onto land and natural resources. That really is the key that every tax reform paper that's ever been produced
you go
in Australia
talks You go and tell the politicians that. That's
well, we
the
do
problem,
go and tell the politicians
they've
that.
They've got a conflict of interest, a lot of them. So we've come to the end of our discussion about your property business. But what I'd like to now go on to is Kehilat Nitzan. We've only got a minute to discuss that you're on the committee.
That's right, I'm on the
and
board.
It's a Masorti synagogue?
It's the only Masorti conservative
congregation.
Synagogue. That's right, in Melbourne.
Yeah.
And we're a brilliant congregation. I encourage everybody to come down and
it's in Hawthorne Road, in the old
Hawthorne
garage.
Hawthorne Road, that's
which has
right.
been beautifully renovated.
Yeah, yeah, not just very close to the to Caulfield Park. And we run an egalitarian traditional community there, so very traditional but egalitarian, so women lead the service as well as men. And we'll be getting a new rabbi soon who will be coming in January.
Jonathan Sadoff.
That's right. So he's in Israel at the moment, but he'll be coming to join us in January. And we have a vibrant children's program there and, you know, a lot of great fun social activities. It's a fantastic community. And if you haven't experienced a conservative Masorti synagogue, then people should feel very welcome to come and
good. And if you want to find Catherine, she's on www.catherinecashmore.com.au.
That's right. That's how you
and we'll be back in the next segment with Rabbi Jonathan Sachs, a video that I found, and it's amazing. It's all about Jerusalem. We're celebrating this week Yom Yerushalayim and also the 50th anniversary of the Six-Day War. So lovely to have you on the show. Thank you. It's been a real pleasure.
Yeah.
And stick around. There's more Shtick.